ॐ सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः समस्तजनकल्याणे निरतं करुणामयम् नमामि चिन्मयं देवं सद्गुरुं ब्रह्मविद्वरम्। Can you little increase? We are seeing this beautiful text, Sadhana Panchakam. Just repeat after me. Vedo nityam adhiyatam tadutitam कर्मस्। तेनेशस्य विधि अपचितिः काम्ये मतिस्त्यज्यताम् पापौघ परिधूयताम् भवसुखे दोषोऽनुसन्धीयताम् वसीयताम् निजगृहात् तूर्णं विनिर्गम्यताम् सत्सु विधीयताम् भगवतो भक्तिर्दृढाधीयताम् शान्त्यादिपरिचीयताम् दृढतरम् कर्माशु सन्त्यज्यताम्। Up to that we saw last time. this is also not giving peace of mind to me. Just suddenly disappears. Okay. It's a peace that doesn't give me any peace. So the peace of mind is, therefore, is to be claimed by all of us. It cannot be provided by any other individual. So you can ask for emotions, love, etc., compassion, love, this and that. So at one level, in our mind level, emotions can be provided by others. Objective pleasures can be provided by others. Comfort and conveniences provided by the objects. But peace of mind is much beyond the mind. So Christ also said, peace that passeth all understanding. The peace is that it is not an understandable object or a perceivable thing. So it is something which we need to claim deep within ourselves. And that is towards that end alone, meditation and puja and all other things. So if you go to a temple and ask, oh Lord, give me peace of mind, what does he give? Chalo le lo ye dil. Can he give us a thing, an object? What do you say? Oh, give me peace of mind. In what way? Oh, everything should happen the way I want. You know, the next person to you is also asking for the same thing. And he doesn't like you, you don't like him. Let us say he wants, oh Lord, give me rain so that I will be peaceful. And you say, please don't have any rain at all because I want peace of mind. Because I am going for a game and if it all rains, then I cannot play the game. Other person says that it's so dry everywhere, my crops are not properly growing and I need rain. So now what will Lord ask him and give then to you or to him? And if he says, okay, you put money more and then I will give you, then he is no better than a local politician. So if really speaking, the Bhagavan will give you the grace in such a way that it doesn't matter whatever happens, you keep your mind peaceful. He cannot be, supporting one and not supporting another. You know, today also I was explaining one particular satsang. See, when the Samudra Mathanam took place, you know, when they were churning the Milky Ocean for the sake of getting Amrutam, the immortal nectar in the story there. So the Milky Ocean, the Meru mountain was put and Vasuki as the rope, and then both the Devatas and Rakshasa and Asuras, they were churning that and they found that this rod is coming up all the time. So they went to Bhagavan Vishnu, say, please, O Lord, do something. So he went in the Garuda and then pushed it down. It went down so fast so that it went just sunk inside. Again they went, oh Lord, please do something. So he went as a tortoise and picked it up and he held it on his back. Then the Devatas came and said, Asuras are so powerful, they are pulling it too much, what do we do? Okay, I will come and help you. Then he became part of the team of the Devatas to pull it. Asuras got upset. You are only helping them. Okay, I will come here also. Here also he started. Now who is doing all this thing now, tell me? From the top, from the bottom, from the right, from the left, everywhere. So when you see that it is Lord's invisible hand is working everywhere, you will be peaceful. That's what I mean here. In good and bad, in right and wrong, in what is happening, what is not happening, if one is able to see the hand of the Supreme, the Lord, then mind becomes peaceful. I will do my best. So that is when real peace is yours. Ashantasya kutas sukam? Bhagavan Krishna asked this question. Prasade sarva dukkanam hani rasyo pajayate prasanna chetaso hasu buddhi paryavatishtate nasti buddhi rayuktasya nacha yuktasya bhavana nachantasya nacha bhavayada shantihi ashantasya kutas sukam. In second chapter of Gita clearly says, if you take everything as a prasad, then peace is yours. Mind will become steady and quiet, and such a quiet mind alone can gain that inner peace. Ashantasya kutas sukam, if you are not peaceful, where is the question of joy, real joy? So therefore, cultivate that peace by understanding that the world of happening cannot become the dictator of what your joy should be. Don't depend your happiness on happenings. It applies. And when you become a man of peace, you will find that wherever you go, you give joy to everyone. When you and I are beggars of peace, wherever we go, we find only misery there. Because everybody is looking for the same thing. I am a beggar, you are a beggar. Let us beg together. Only that we can do. I cannot beg from you. You cannot beg from me because I am also a beggar, you are also a beggar. Then, beggars corporation we can create. And then we can be, everybody will be begging. That is what happens. Everybody is looking for peace and nobody is giving. So where an individual has discovered in oneself the peace, that such a person becomes shantaha. That shantaha becomes saint in Sanskrit, in English, saint, man of saintliness, pleasantness, joyful, peaceful presence. Now, one may say, in the world outside, when you, Swamiji, all these are a wonderful philosophy, but we have to work in this world, not like you. So, we have to be, so many people, Swamiji, my boss is the most atrocious person I can ever face in this world. So much of challenge, so much of competition, so much of this, what do we do? So, here in the next statement, he says, Dridadaram karmashu santyajyatam. We have to find out, we have to broadly divide the action into three parts. That needs to be done, that which needs to be shunned, that we can optionally do. So when we understand these three broad categories, to be done, optionally it can be done, should not be done. Now ask this question, are you agitated about things which, because you want to do that which should not be done? So that requires some thinking. Am I doing things which are not necessary to be done and forsaking what is to be done? Many times when we are doing things which we feel like doing, it is not necessarily that we are not compromising. We are compromising something which is optionally to be done or which is not to be done. Let us say that you are unhappy with someone or whatever, your boss or your friend or your wife or husband or somebody. Now, to get angry and shout at them, it is to be done, optionally to be done and should not be done. Tell me which category you belong to. To shout and get hurt and get other person hurt also. It is like Buddha beautifully said, anger is that, it is like drinking poison and expect somebody else to die. You are drinking poison. I hope he dies. You are drinking poison. So when we realize that, that doesn't serve any purpose. It is only going to hurt you more and more. So what do? It is to be shunned. You see, thinking about that, you know, what is it necessary or is it optional or it is to be shunned? So we can recognize that this need not be taken up. So to that extent you are peaceful, you forgive that person, finished. With no regrets, because I know that is not to be done. Then second category, are you forsaking what is to be done for the sake of what you would like to do? If you are doing something which you are, it's choice. If you don't do also, nobody is bothered about that. It is your personal pleasure. For personal pleasure, when you are doing something, forsaking what is to be done otherwise, then, see, for example, if I need to remain healthy so that I can work well and I take unnecessarily some kind of food which I like to eat and overeat, who is responsible for that then? Who is responsible? Can you blame somebody else for that? No, I made a mistake of eating this unnecessarily. Now I am suffering out of ill health. No, you cannot blame anyone. You gave me, therefore I eat. Don't blame your wife. She put it on the plate, you have every right to push it away. So in the same way, I'm just giving an example. Certain things which you can optionally, you are doing optionally because of your desire, kamya karma. And you are forsaking and not doing your kartavya karma. What is to be done? So when you come to this, encountering this between shreyas and prayas, what is to be, what is good and what is mere pleasure, there also you one must give more importance to what is to be done and not what one would like to do. Now once you remove that also, then stick to what is to be done and you will find peace is yours. So this requires some amount of deep thinking, because I cannot play your role and you cannot play my role. You as individuals have to understand what is that which I am supposed to do and what is that which I choose to do. Somebody said beautifully, when you start loving what you do, you never work a single day in your life. When you start loving what you do, you don't need to work a single day in your life. Why? Because what is to be done, I start loving it, then there is no question of me sweating and toiling about it. So here he says, dridadaram karmashu santyajyata. Do not get attached to that work, because the action is only a means to an end. Just like when you are traveling in a place from one place to another, you are traveling by train, you are not attached to the train, are you? Oh my dear train, you took me all the way from here to there, how will I give you up? In the same way, understand, action is a means to an end. Perform it as diligently, as skillfully, as much as you can, but understand, it is a means. Many people become so workaholic for two reasons. They love the work, one. They are afraid to go home is the second one. So I do not know which category you belong. I mean, I don't love work at all. That's a wonderful thing. So attachment to work is, what happens is that you cannot think anything else. Your mind is caught up in that. As much as money is a means to a thing, right? If I have money, I can go buy and things. But I am not attached to money, because if you get attached to money, you can never spend. That's what happens to people, you know, attached to money. Hold on. And what's the use of holding on to your money where it cannot be used? So in the same way, action is a means to an end, and therefore attachment to action means unintelligent thinking there. Another thing is, if you do a thing and achieve something, if somebody else can do better than you, is it better to you make that person do it and then you become a manager? Is it not true? You see, if I can do and achieve certain things, and if somebody else whom I can depend on can do a much better job than me, it's better to give it to that person. We are so poor in delegation. When you only delegate, you get detached, I'm telling you. But that doesn't mean you ask for any job, not that way. Do it efficiently and make sure that it is efficiently passed on to somebody else so that you can do better things. That means as the child, your daughter becomes, let us say, 12-year, 13-year-old, ask her to make the breakfast, not you. That by passing on that action, you can do better things. So then at the same time, you will check on yourself whether I am attached to that work or not. Only when you give it to somebody else, who may not do the same way, but you will recognize whether I am attached to this work or not. If you are attached to work, you will never give up. So the maturity should come slowly, 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 that action is only a means to an end. And action, I want to say that I am working, and then afterwards, by working more and more, I get, let us say, more and more money. Out of the money, I get more and more conveniences and comforts. And out of that comforts and conveniences, I live happy. And the happiness gives me a lot of peace. If you can get peace without all these things, then why do you have to go through all that? Swamiji, you mean to say I should not work at all? You know, the famous story is, one American was traveling in Mexico and he saw one fellow was sitting and fishing. a few things he fished, he was fishing and putting it in his box. And he was sitting and drinking a beer and eating that fish and fried. So this person went and said, "You only fish this much, collect this much fish only. How long it took?" "Half a day." "In half a day only this much fish you got?" "Yeah." "So you know your rod that you are using and all those things are very primitive, and also you should go inside the interior to that sea and you get better fishes." "Oh yeah, so you hire a boat, go inside the and then get more fishes, and then you can therefore take some and then you can put it in the market and you get some money. After some time you will get your own boat also, better equipments. And you can go and then you can fish more and you sell it in the market, you can get more money and then you get more boats. You can employ people to fish for you and use it. And after some time you have a fish company also. Sit there and then all the people are working and you enjoy. Sit there and relax." He said, "I'm doing already." Why do I have to go through all those things? But that doesn't mean that you should do nothing. Here, when it comes to peace, if you are peaceful, your work will express that. And what we are doing is the other way around. We are working hard and hard and so become peace and then looking for, where is the peace now? So, if you have discovered the inner peace itself, then the work will be an expression of that peace. Gurudev said, work is love expressed. When the expression of love is work. So when we have recognized that the peace is within me, work should be an expression of that, then kartavya karma or any karma, any action that you do is not anymore a burden. Because the detachment has already come. You are looking, not looking for something out of the work. You are expressing the joy of love to the world. Why the saints and sages, so they worked so hard, 24 hours a day, continuously, without any rest, constantly moving around. Are they forced to do anything? No. They were working because they love. There's no attachment. If the work is taken away from them, not that they get deprived or anything. That's why he says, give up the attachment. Karma ashu santyajyata. Give up that attachment to that work. Do the work. Fulfillment, and don't look for that in the work. The work should not become the means to your joy. It is means to an end outside. And our idea is that if I get this, if I get, I will be joyful. That concept has to change. Discover the peace within and let the work be an expression of that. Then not a single day you are at work. And work will not become a burden. And even if there is no work, it's not you are going to be deprived at all. Swamiji, these are all fine, but how do we maintain this thought again and again? Because if the moment I walked out of this room, everything is forgotten. So how do we maintain this kind of understanding all the time? Now you see the next verse he says, Sadvidvan upasrupyatam pratidinam tatpaduka sevyatam. So the two more instructions he gives here. Sadvidvan upasrupyatam. Approach a teacher who has understanding of the truth. Sat. Sat means that absolute truth, he who knows. Now you see, what is then which is called as Sat Satyam? We must recognize this very carefully. Bhagavan Krishna says in chapter 15 of Gita, whatever you see in this world is one reality. Whatever you don't see is another reality. And beyond that, there is one more. He says, dva imau purushau loke. There are two powers in this world. Sharascha aksharascha. Very scientific approach to understanding of what is sat. What you see in this world as matter is one reality. What you do not see but still exists is another reality. For example, I see you are all physically existing, right? You also see me. But can I see your thought or can you see my thought? Thank God, you can't. But because I do not see, it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. It exists because you and you know it, your thought. That is called relative reality. You know it, but I don't know it. So at one level, it is Sat means that which is externally known, perceivable thing. But that alone is not the real. There is something else which is there, but you don't see it. You know, when some 2-3 days back, I was just walking, looking outside the window. Every car was slowing down in that road. I said, why it is slowing down? Traffic light is far away. Why is it slowing down? And I found that there was a police car sitting there, just opposite our building. So everybody is coming, this is fast and slow down. So, you don't see the cop, but you see the cop's car. That is called law of nature. Law of nature is something which you don't see, but it is there. Like law of gravitation, law of magnetic principles, and all those things, you don't see it, but it is there. Blessing us all the time. If you are putting a seed in the ground and it grows, that is a law of nature. It works, you don't see it. Physically you don't see it, but you know it. So one is perception, another is called conception. You conceive an idea, you perceive an object. Your object you perceive, but thoughts you conceive. You don't perceive objects. So the law of nature is that which you know, but you can't see it. So that car was standing, everybody was slowing down because they know the law works. If the police is there and if I'm going fast, then I'm in trouble. And the whole day it was there, car. So I was very curious. I went down, looked at it. No cops, only car. Now you see, the car itself has that power without even a cop. Just like the temple, the Murti is there. Bhagavan is not there. Only Murti is there. Where is the Bhagavan? In your head. The idea of God is in your head. What is there is only a Murti. Similarly, car is there. Cop is in your head. Meaning, what will happen if you don't follow the law? Is it not that thought is yours in your mind? Consequence. So Bhagavan Krishna says, there is a something called visible things. Then there is an invisible power, like a law of nature. One he calls it as Ksharam, another he calls it Aksharam. Perishable, because matter, that which is there, visible, anything visible is Ksharam, subject to perishing. That which is invisible but present is relatively imperishable. Kutastha it's called. It is there as a constant factor which governs the world. Law of nature. Prakriti, Maya. That's what we are worshipping for 9 days. The power that is present, invisible power which governs the nature, the world. Three forms, Durga, Lakshmi and Saraswati. So, the invisible power is present, though you are not seeing it, but you know it. Krishna says, there is another one. So one is reality according to perceivable reality. Another is called relative reality, which is you cannot see but you know it. The third one is absolute reality. Absolute reality is that which neither can be seen nor it can be known in any other means, but it is present. As you, your own being, self, awareness. Paramatma iti cha udagrada yo lokatrayam avishya bibartya avyaya ishvara. So that which is governing this world on all the laws, but at the same time, it is absolute, meaning at the level of the world, it is called God. At the level of the absolute, it is called Brahman. Just like you are seeing, all of us are seeing things. But can we see space? Between you and the next person, there is something, right? What? Space. Can you see it? No. But you can, do you know it? Yes, it is there. Even when all the objects are absent, does the space exist or not? In the same way, in this world, the objects are there, law of objects are, the law of nature is there. Even if they are absent, there is one thing which is present, which is always there, that is called absolute. That is what is referred called satyam, real, absolute reality. So, Krishna says, that absolute reality, he who knows, he is called a Mahatma. He is called a man of understanding. Yo maam evam asammudaha janadi parameshwaram. Such a person who knows me as the original nature, absolute nature. Janadi purushottamam, sorry. Yo maam evam asammudaha janadi purushottamam sa sarvavit bhajadi maam sarva bhavena bharata. He worships me in every way. In every form he will worship. Such a person is called Sat Purusha. One who knows what is Sat. One should approach such a master, Sat Vidwan Upasrupyatam. Man of knowledge who is a Vidwan, man who is capable of explaining that. Vidvatvam asti asya asti idi Vidwan. He who has Vidvatvam, ability to explain through the scriptures. So, Upasrupyada. Upasrupya means approach with all humility. Our Gurudev used to say, people are very funny, you know. They do not know how to approach a teacher also. So, they take the phone. Hi, Guru is available there? Yes, I have to ask you a question. It's like calling a friend or calling. Upasrupya means with humility, with reverence and respect. Because such a guru is not a scholar of the philosophy department, who may probably refer to all the books and explain to you. He who is attempting to live that knowledge, then he is a guru. Otherwise, he is only a teacher. So, that is why it is a beautiful difference between Acharya and a guru. Acharya is one who is teacher. Guru is one who is personally guiding you. It is guru. When he guides everybody in general, he is a teacher. But when he individually takes concern and care about an individual and guides him or her through everywhere, then that person becomes a guru. You are a devotee of a thing, but when you become a disciple, when you cannot say, I am a disciple of nobody. I am a disciple means there must be a guru there. Meaning one who personally attends to your spiritual growth. Anyway, so you approach the teacher with all reverence and respect to maintain this thought process properly. What is to be done, what is optionally can be done, and what should be shunned. This knowledge should be clear so that we will work in this world detached and we are able to achieve inner peace. Sat Vidvan Upasarpyatam and Pradidinam Tat Paduka Sevyatam. Meaning, worship the feet of the Guru, meaning worship the knowledge he stands for. Not the physical padukas, physical feet. Even though physical feet we worship, it is symbolically representing that knowledge he or she stands for is to be revered and respected. What you respect and revere, you love, and what you love, you learn. It is such a simple logic there. If you don't have a respect for something, you can never love that. Or if that love is only lusty, passionate and pleasure. But what you respect, you love, and what you love, you learn quickly. That's why, you know, the idea is that students, they have to start, oh, my son doesn't study at all because he doesn't have a respect for that knowledge. If he has the relevance and respect for the knowledge, he will love it. Once you love it, you don't need to teach that person. You'll learn. So, once you have the respect and reverence for the teacher and the teaching, then that knowledge will just flow. That's why the paduka, sevanam, paduka, sevyatam, tat paduka, sevyatam. We'll see more of it in the next session.